Jeff, welcome back to NUQ, where you've been many times before. And I'm going to begin with a simple question, perhaps. What inspired the World Internet Project?
Well, Dean Dennis, it's wonderful to be here. I'm an old television guy. I always knew, working in television, studying it, it was the most powerful medium ever invented. And I was always taught that we lost a great opportunity to understand how television changed the world.
In what way?
What we should have done, I was taught, in the 40s when television first came in, we should have tracked people before they had television and then gone back to them year after year as they acquired and used it to see where the time for television came from, how it changed our buying behavior, and a thousand other things. And in the 90s, I think it was obvious that digital, first the web, now mobile, was going to be far more important than television. So believing that we lost this opportunity with television and that digital was going to be more important, 18 years ago, we started tracking digital in a way we thought we should have done.
So you had the idea to do this, but having the idea doesn't get it done. You obviously have put together a team in Los Angeles that at the
we
Annenberg
were at
School.
UCLA when we started. We now moved to the Annenberg
right.
School. I had a great team of researchers to choose from. I had an extraordinary global team of advisors to give us input. And we decided we wanted it to be global, so we were going to do the work in the U.S., but we announced about 9 months before we released data that we were doing it, got a lot of attention, and we started getting inquiries from Singapore, Italy, Sweden, and all of a sudden we were doing 6 or 7 countries. Now we're in 35 countries.
So in a sense, it was an idea whose time had come. You found people, at least some people, who were already interested in probing the internet, maybe even doing it locally, but there really wasn't an international, global enterprise of this kind.
No, and I think people understood that the internet was going to grow in importance. Yeah. It was going to change almost every element of our lives, although we never could have anticipated that billions of people would access the internet through a little device in their pockets or purses, or that one social network, which didn't, there were no social networks, would have 2.2 billion users. But we knew the internet was pretty darned important.
And the internet has changed over time. It's moved through different stages, different generations. How has that influenced your work?
Well, if we, you know, we tried to make this a longitudinal study so that we could create a baseline. And I had advisors, my dear friend John Robinson, who did the time use study at Maryland.
Yes.
John's argument was, don't ever change a question. You'll lose the comparison. But if we had never done a question, there'd be no social networks, there'd be no mobile phones, we would be locked into the 20-year-old. So this thing's evolving constantly, the ways in which the world's changing, the political impact, a president who's a tweeter-in-chief, and the role, I mean, it's constantly evolving. We're losing some of the benchmark longitudinality, but we have to.
I know you've talked about internet or web 1.0, 1.2.0, the 3.0. What's that mean?
Well, web 1.0 was the original web. Slow speed, it was really the dial-up web. Yeah. You could do simple things, but it really was from the internet to us. You could read newspapers online, you could check facts. The web 2.0 really came with broadband, with the faster speeds. And all of a sudden you could share videos. Everybody became a content creator. Facebook arose in that era. And I think web 3.0 is where there are no limitations. And web 3.0, we'll never talk about broadband speed ever again. When we walk into our house and turn on the lights, we don't say to ourselves, I really hope that electricity is strong enough to power. It's just there and does what we want. And it's in a Web 3.0 world that we're seeing driverless cars, that we're seeing massive changes in every element. Television, my God, in 20 years, what the television business is unrecognized.
So where have we come? Television, the set looks similar, although we now have flat panels as opposed to the old cathode ray tubes. The physical television, somewhat similar, but the content and the means of production are quite different.
Well, in 1975, in the U.S., 90% of television viewing came from three places. Our broadcast networks. Yes. Those broadcast networks now account for about 33%. There are hundreds of networks specialized. But then there are places like YouTube that are just phenomenal in letting people create with no standards whatsoever, which is wonderful and terrifying, creating massive amounts of programming. And then broadband has allowed services like Netflix and Hulu and Amazon Prime. Right. So the whole television business looks very different. This year in America, the over-the-top, the internet services will produce about $21 billion worth of original programming, over twice what the studios and broadcast networks produce.
The internet used to be talked about as a electronic system of a digital system where everybody could communicate with everybody else all over the world, which seemed improbable at one time, but now is within reach, or is it?
One of the first things that was obvious the internet was going to change was the ability to communicate. It doesn't take that long ago to remember what a call from Qatar to the United States would have cost. I think it probably would have been $6, $7, $8 a minute. Calling globally is now free. We can have friends across the world as easily as we can across the street. Qatar, a country where there are so many expats and foreign workers, 25 years ago, couldn't have called home. Or maybe once a month would have saved up for a 2-minute phone call. I watched them. They now call home six times a day. It really has brought the world closer in that way.
So have we conquered time and distance?
We have I do a lot of work in Australia. I think 30 years ago, Australia, which is the most remote big country on Earth, there were benefits and disadvantages to being so remote. I think today there are only advantages. I think all of the problems of distance and time have largely disappeared. They are connected to the world. They watch the same content. They can communicate with the world. They're not penalized by being so far away, except if they want to go somewhere, they have to sit there in an airplane seat for a long time. So yeah, I really do believe we've conquered time and distance. One quick example, in 2003, when the SARS virus first appeared, we didn't know if that was just a minor little virus or the next black plague. Historically, it used to take about 10 months to diagnose a virus. In that case, in 2003, the North American laboratories would work a full day, pass that information on to the Asian laboratories as the American and Canadians went to sleep. As the Asians went to sleep, they passed it on to the Middle East and to Europe. They diagnosed that virus in 6 days, the ability to collaborate.
So this is really all about speed as well, right?
It's speed, and I think one of the other defining characteristics, it's the consumer has become a massive winner. And access to information, immediacy. Think about, you could take 100 areas. Think about that today's teenagers will take 100, if not 1,000 times more photographs than we take. And how much will they spend on photography in their lifetime? Maybe $20, and they'll be able to share it in a way that wasn't possible. They can listen to far more music than we've ever listened to. They don't have to clutter their house. So, and those are just two examples. The consumer, the user, has really become the winner.
It would seem that there are many advantages and benefits of the internet, multiple ones. You could make lists of hundreds, thousands of things. But there's also a concern about the dark side of the internet. How about that dark side? Privacy
issues?
There is
a real dark web. There have always been evil players in the world, and these digital tools that have so improved the quality of life for so many of us, those same tools are available to evil actors, and they are using it to violate privacy. They're using it to organize terrorism and crime. They are using it in ways that we only begin to understand And most of us are not well equipped to know how to fight that. Fraud and scams are at an all-time level. There really is a dark web.
And of course, as you know very well from your work and research over the years, there's always been kind of a legacy of fear when it comes to technologies. Television was going to ruin one's eyesight, or corrupt children, or bring more violence. And the world hasn't fallen apart, so we can understand some of those kind of concerns on the one hand, but the legacy of fear could affect the telephone and many, many things. But as we look out 10, 20 years from now, will we look back on this era and say, geez, this was kind of a primitive time, the internet, the web was just beginning to get going, and it took off in multiple different directions without asking you to be a seer. Your feeling about that?
I genuinely believe that 100, 1,000 years from now, the era in which we are in now will be seen as the beginning of digital technology. Every generation since the Greeks have said change has never come so fast.
Right. Yeah.
I think this time it's true.
Yeah.
And it's only coming faster. So I think constant massive change is becoming an everyday factor in life.
And so how do we deal with that as people, as individuals, as opposed to institutional responses?
I think we try to learn as much as we think is useful to us, and we don't try to be overwhelmed, and we pick and choose the kinds of things we want to understand and be part of. Clearly, smartphones have made it past that point. I can't imagine now being a teenager in high school and not having a smartphone.
Right.
You know, you wouldn't be able to. But I think we try to figure out the things that we want to participate in.
Well, you know, Jeff, we're in a media school, and I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you what advice you would give our students who will be future leaders of the media and communication industry. Just a bullet or two on what advice, what should they do?
They need to be paying attention, to be learning. I talk a lot. They need to be thinking about when they get out of school where the jobs are going to be. That's an issue, not of great concern, but an issue they need to pay attention to. They need, I think, to really understand how the technology works. Now, they don't have to be a coder. You know, we were able to take advantage of automobiles in our lives, even though almost none of us, if we opened the hood, could fix the car. They don't have to be able to explain it as a programmer or an expert, but they need to understand how to use this technology and work. And I think Northwestern NUQ is doing a phenomenal job of helping them understand it in their studies.
If there's one driving force that will most affect the digital future in your mind, would that be just people's habits? Would it be political or policy decisions? What is going to drive the future?
I don't think there are important policy decisions to be made. I think you're going to start to see Facebook and Amazon and Google subject to more regulation and antitrust. But I don't think those are going to be defining characteristics. I think it's going to be the way people use or misuse the technology. And there is some real concern about addiction. I mean, it's sad when you hear about families that text each other inside the house to come to dinner, and the people who never put their faces down from the phone. The new Apple 10, the new 10S and 10S Max, now has a feature called Screen Time, which is designed to show you how much time you're spending online and what areas. We'll see if that awareness helps at all, but I think how we use it's the
So consciousness is really, it's all about consciousness. Well, Jeff, thank you very much for being here at NUQ and for sitting down here in the newsroom today for a few questions.
My pleasure, always happy to be here. What you're doing, what's happening at NUQ is really remarkable, and it's just a joy to be included in part of it.